Good morning. It's good to see everybody. I spent about 20 years of my life living, working, and traveling in Asia, North America, and parts of Europe. And I travel so much to the extent that sometimes I wake up in the middle of the night wondering where I am. And I can assure the audience it's not due to a hangover. But when I was given this topic, I wanted to share a little bit about my anecdotal observation of globalization as I travel for the past 20 years. And what I found was it was a phenomenon that's highly paradoxical. We understand McDonaldization of the globe. Many people have written about it. I'm sure you have read about this. But there is an opposing force of the need to localize. Potato chips have flavors in tom yum from Thailand and masala from India. There is a need for people to continue to retain their unique identity as much as globalization has gone across the globe. We have seen unprecedented cross-border trade. That has brought, supposedly to bring goods and services across the globe, help people to better their life. But what we do see, unfortunately, is an ever-widening income gap. This is where I took a photo in Tokyo, where a homeless person is sleeping in front of a very luxurious mall. We see massive capital movement across the globe, investment funds and so on, that has been moving around. What we also see is we have seen more financial crises in recent history than ever before. We have massive, massive inflation. Most real wages have stagnated or fallen behind, where prices have continued to keep going up and up. It's just harder to live now in other parts of the world. I'm sure you in the United States here, many people feel that same way. Overpriced property, there is some sense that prices are sort of under control in the United States, but it's going up again. We see that young couples, professional couples, who have graduated with good jobs cannot afford housing in their cities because it's gone so much. In the last 3 to 5 years, some properties have appreciated by 30 to 40%. Urbanization, I'm a city boy, I love urbanization, it's beautiful, I like that. But a lot of that comes with the yields of urbanization. Part of it is the attraction for more jobs and people as a rural to urban migration that has been, again, I don't believe that this is precedented in any part of our history. But that has put on a heavy burden on the resources of the mega cities. And so people are finding hard to get jobs. We see squatters littered all around the fringes of major cities in the world. We see that people could not afford homes. And this is a photo in Hong Kong of a person living in a cage. People are beginning to live like animals. Environmental pollution is another problem that we have. This is not a road, it's a river of garbage. And people drink from it. This is from Jakarta. We see traffic congestion all over now in major cities. People are spending an average about 1.5 to 2 hours to get to work. I know people who go to work one way for 3 hours, taking public transport. It is a terrible, terrible way to live. We find the globalized world being more interconnected than ever before. We have our 4G network, our smartphones. We have fiber optics connectivity. But yet, in that phenomenon, we see that people are more and more disconnected with each other. Movies like Disconnect, Men, Women, and Children, in recent memories, shows and highlights this phenomenon that the more connected we are, it seems that the more connected we are, the less connected people are actually with people. So where does that lead us? Well, where is the growth? The six largest megacities, according to Forbes magazine, are in Asia: Delhi, Shanghai, Tokyo, Yokohama, Manila, Jakarta, Seoul, Incheon. The fastest growing megacities are not in the developed world, but in the two-thirds world, you know, and mainly in Asia, in Africa, and Latin America. Another interesting phenomenon is that tribes and nations are being redefined in a certain way. Where we used to define our nationality, our identity, by the nation that we live in, born in, by the language that we speak, or by our ethnicity that we are born with, more and more these days, we are identified also by our jobs, our vocation. Just think about industry conferences that you attend. You have been there for many years, and you realize that even across the globe, you meet the same people at the same conferences. And each industry approach a issue, a perspective, in a unique way. Imagine an engineer and a doctor and a social scientist talking about a problem. They come from very, very different angles. So what has that got to do with our Christian faith? Let me try to bring across a few ideas and then try to bring them back together. First is, it's not explored extensively or hardly explored, is the concept that our Jesus, who died on the cross, died for the entire created order, not just people. And we only seem to be interested in converting people and saving their souls. But the implication of this needs to be further explored, because God so loved the cosmos that he gave his only son. And I think we need, as the church, we need to explore deeper and what that means when Christ redeemed everything. The second idea, as been brought forward by Dr. Chris Wright, is the reclamation of the Abrahamic covenant. That the body of Christ, the people of God, need to be a blessing to the nation. That we were saved not because it was a nice thing to have for us. It was because saved for a purpose, is to become a blessing to the nations. It comes to the vision of a shalom society, which I think, again, within the Christian psyche has been lost. Chinese are not very good with words. I probably believe that, you know, we have used 8 characters to describe shalom society. Feng Yi Zhu Shi, the first 4 characters on the top, means to have abundance to wear and enough food to eat. It comes from the concept of Jesus, who says, seek first the kingdom of heaven, you know, and do not worry about what you shall wear and what you shall eat. The second is an ju le ye, an ju, which means to live in peace. The idea from Isaiah 65, where you will plant vineyards, and you build houses and live in it, you will plant vineyards and eat from it. And le ye, which I think is very unique for the Chinese psyche, is to be happy at our work, to be happy at our jobs, and the ability to be able to live out work in peace and harmony, enjoying that. Ecclesiastes give us a glimpse of that, but not entirely. So the shalom vision needs to be reclaimed by the Christian community, what it means to be a blessing to the nation. Catherine has alluded to this: seek the shalom of the city, seek the welfare of the city. Okay. In Lausanne, Pattaya, some of our friends have been here with us in 2004, we talk about the 3 great commissions rather than 1 great commission. The 3 great commission being the evangelistic commission, the relational commission to love God and to love neighbor, and the creation commission to have dominion over his created order, Genesis 1:28. So we don't see this as 3 separate ones, but as the 3 commission emerging from the Trinitarian perspective of our Trinitarian God. And this has a lot been written extensively by Dr. Gordon Priest, who is among us today. So, problems with globalization, our call as Christian, what are opportunities for believers at the workplace? I think one is to begin to reclaim the idea that people of God minister in the world of work from Monday to Saturday. That the church, the people of God, are gathered on Sunday and scattered and dispersed into the world of business, education, healthcare, family, arts and culture, and so on and so forth. The church gathered and scattered. It's the rhythm of the week. One of the things that I've observed over the years is that Christians, even who those who see this workplace ministry and hold it strongly, they work as almost as individual. But in the globalized world, we need to work within a system and network, because the problems that we deal with in the city and across the globe are interconnected, interlinked. One thing affects the other. So you need governance. You need the businesses to work together. You need to use technology to enable some of the things that needs to be done. You need to build communities around them, etc., etc. You need to build the financial infrastructure. You need to build the physical infrastructure to enable an entire community, entire city to begin to function, entire nation to begin to function. One of the things that Christians do not do very well, I think, over the years is to leverage on the resources that are at our disposal. Many of us work in multinational companies. Many of us work in tech companies, or small, medium enterprises, or social enterprises. Many work in NGOs and, you know, in the government sector, in policy making, in the academia, you know, where you do research, trending, and forward looking. We need to leverage on all these resources that we have and work with each other to discuss and talk through how do we deal with an issue that has so many aspects. In the Graduates Fellowship in Singapore, we have got different professional groups coming together, partnering with each other to work out some of the social issues and talk about this in a slightly more integrated manner. We're still working hard at it, but it's not an easy thing, but it is a necessary thing. We need an urban strategy that will address our towns, our cities, our nation, and our region and across the globe. Because all our strategies have been hit and run. You know, we do something here, we do a little bit there. But we do not, as the body of Christ, within a city, collaborate and work with each other across the globe to work with each other. Believers in multinationals that span across the globe to come together and work towards strategies that will bring good products and services to people who actually need them. The bottom of the pyramid business, again, is a wonderful opportunity for that. So how do we begin to address the negative impact of Christ's cosmic redemption? It's by building a shalom society through believers working together in the marketplace or the workplace. I think that's the only way where when believers begin to own that we have a purpose to live out here, that we need to address the issues of globalization and to minimize that impact, that we begin to see thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is here and sits in heaven. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. That was terrific.
Part of the problem with globalization is that we have just offshored our problems, particularly in the United States. So 100 years ago in New York City, you had the shirtwaist triangle factory fire. The factory gates were locked. Fire ensued. Hundreds of women jumped to their death. Last fall in India, you had the Tazreen factory fire. Making shirts for consumers in Manhattan, in the United States, the factory doors were locked, hundreds of women died. And so essentially what globalization has done is it's just allowed us to take our problems and move them somewhere else, move them to the disadvantaged. And I loved what you said about being a blessing to the nations, about working together. How would we as Christians remember our brothers and sisters? How are we going to remember those impacts? How are we going to work to change that so we don't just use globalization to offshore our problems?
Well, I think one of the misconceptions is that you're not offshoring your, when you offshore your problems, people don't realize that you have created a new set of problems for yourselves. So the problem exists, no matter where it is in the world. I think what we do need is to begin to think about putting good policies, good business practices, good HR policies in place so that we do not exploit people. The whole problem here is that we are exploiting the developing world. I think that is the mindset. So there needs to be a balance between that and the business environment that we are all working in, the global environment that we are all working in. Because the global environment is fallen. It is imperfect. And we need to wrestle with that. Most of our choices is not between what is right and wrong, but most of the time it's between what is bad and worse. And so what we do need sometimes is to have that mindset to minimize issues. If we can't eradicate it, at least what can we do to minimize the impact, the negative impacts of globalization?